Good evening, guys. Welcome to the session. We're going to talk about the budget 2015 today. Before we start, please confirm if you can see me and hear me. Audio and video, guys, please confirm. Yeah, can you see me and hear me? Anybody has a problem with either audio or video? Okay, great, fine. So I've got a few confirmations saying that audio and video is fine. So I'm assuming that the audio and video is fine and working for everybody. Aditya, what's the problem with the video? Yeah, did you click on the video icon, which along with the bullseye administrator in your chat box, the name? So there's a small video icon, camera icon. Did you click on that? Please click on that. I think your video will be fine. Anybody else with a video or audio problem? Aditya, is your problem sorted out? So in the left side, you have the attendees box, and over there, one of the attendees is the bullseye administrator. So where you see the bullseye administrator written, you'll see a red camera. Looks like a video camera, right? That icon. Just click on that red video camera icon. You should get video. Yeah, okay. Okay, shall we start, guys? Everybody's got audio and video. Okay, so fine. So we're going to talk about the budget session today. So essentially, we're going to talk about an event which happened just about a couple of days ago. So I think it should be pretty fresh in your minds, albeit if you have gone through the budget. So tell me, has anybody gone through the budget? Not the entire document, but, you know, news, newspapers, anything? I'm sure all of you would have done the headlines at least. The main points of the budget, the headlines you would have gone through. Great. So I'm going to try and take you through a little deeper into the budget of the year. Okay. And there might be some points which you already aware. If that is the case, great. But I hope to give you a lot of insight into the points of the budget itself along with the impact of those points. Okay. So that's the way we've got to structure the session. So I'll tell you what the budget announced, along with that, the impact of those announcements. Fine. So let's start. Before I go into the budget for this year, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the basic terms which you need to understand to in order to understand the budget. Okay. So the budget, first of all, of course, I'm sure most of you are aware, it's the statement of account for the union government of any country actually, but here we're talking about India, right? So the union budget is the statement of account. It shows the incomes and expenditures of the government of the country for a period of 1 year. That period is generally the financial year, which is from 1st April to 31st of March, right? So the budget shows the incomes and expenses of the government of India for the period 1st April to 31st March. I think that's pretty simple, guys. Can I move on? Anything else you want me to explain here? Shubham, it's a financial year. Essentially, it's a practice which has been adopted from the Western countries, European countries, essentially, because the US financial year is the calendar year. So if you look at American corporates and how they report their incomes and expenses for a year, they report it from 1st of January to the 31st of December. But European countries do it from 1st April to 31st March. So we've adopted the British system, actually. Okay, so it's called the financial year. Yeah. Yes, anything else so far? Okay, going on. So that's the annual financial statement. The budget is also called the annual financial statement. Okay. The revenue budget and the capital budget are two terms which I think you need to understand in a little more detail. let me just try and bring this up for you on the whiteboard. So I'm going to make a whiteboard for you guys, and let's try and show you the budget of the country. So so an income and expenses statement excuse me, looks like this, right? It's a T table, and on one side you have the incomes and on one side you have the expenses, right? What are the major incomes of any government, guys? What is a government earn income from? Absolutely, the biggest and the most important head is taxes. Sorry, taxes. What kind of taxes, Samira? What are the different types of taxes? There are two, actually. Yes, again, correct. So there is the direct and the indirect. So direct taxes include income tax and corporate tax and wealth tax, whereas indirect taxes include all the taxes which are not directly levied on an individual or a corporation's income. They include taxes like customs duties, import duties, that is, excise duties, service tax, sales tax, VAT. All of these are the indirect taxes. Okay, both are paid directly to the government, Shubham. It is what is taxed. The distinction is what is taxed. In the direct taxes, an individual or a corporation's income is taxed, whereas in indirect taxes, products and services are taxed. Okay, Kinsukh, we'll have to come to that. I'll come to that a little later. But if you're talking about income tax, it's a very, very small, negligible percentage, right? It's closer to single digits. Yeah. So it's like about 4 to 5% of the population. Yeah, it's about 4 to 5% of the population which pays income tax, if that's what you're talking about. Anyway, so these are the two major sources of income. Anything else, guys, on the income side? Where else does a government earn money from? Varun, for the rest of the group, can you explain what is divestment? What do you mean, Shubham? Why does the government not leave it? What do you mean? Yeah, Varun, that's correct. Shubham, I'm still waiting for understanding your questioning, but why does the populist government not stop? What do you mean not stop? Stop doing what? Levying income tax. Okay. What would you have them levy instead? You're saying the entire thing should be converted to service tax and sales tax? Sure, it's a nice idea, but see, the point is very simple. Yeah, a lot of people may not be buying those products and services, right? A lot of people may not be buying certain products and services. Suppose you decide to charge 30% taxes on school fee. It's a service, or maybe a college tuition fee. And somebody is a senior citizen. The guy and his wife, senior citizens both, living in a house. And therefore, they have only, let us say, rental income or interest income. Because they don't have college tuitions, they don't go to college, or they don't have any kids going to college, they will not pay any tax. So a certain part of the population may end up paying no tax because of the way services and products are structured. Not everybody is consuming everything, right? So that is why income tax has to be levied, so that the entire population gets covered, right? And the reverse is also true, okay? A lot of people don't pay income tax because they are poor. And those people are still consuming products and services, so there is a certain tax element over there as well. Okay, so direct and indirect taxes, guys. Let me just come back and quickly see what the questions are here. Okay, so Varun, you're right. The second head here is, we will not call it divestment or disinvestment, we will call it income from assets. There's a reason why I'm saying this. Service tax is an indirect tax, Abhishek. Kinsook, its basic terminology, duty is basically used for imports or export transactions, whereas taxes are more domestic terminology, but essentially they are both taxes. Okay. Okay. Any other questions? Just let me see if I've left out any question, and then I'll come back to income from assets. Right. Okay. So income from assets. There's a reason, like I said, why I've not written disinvestment here, because disinvestment. Abhishek, let me come to that in a couple of minutes. Income from assets is basically not just selling assets. I may sell my assets, and which Varun called divestment or disinvestment. I can also earn income from operating my assets, right? So one source of income is sale of assets, and one source of income from assets is operations. So let me just explain these two to you. So I can sell assets. So instead of, you know, operating my assets, I can sell my assets, which means I can sell a government's share in a government owned company. So government can sell its ownership, its share of ownership in, let us say, a PSU like Coal India, or let us say a PSU like NTPC, National Thermal Power Corporation. So I can sell ownership, and that's income for me. I can even sell resources like telecom spectrum, resources like land. Okay, so the government owns certain resources, national resources, it can sell those resources. Okay, so income from sale of assets, okay, and the income from operations. I can operate these companies. So I can operate Coal India. Coal India will earn a profit. From that profit, Coal India will give dividend to its owners. That dividend is income for the government, right? So please understand, guys, when a PSU does its business, okay, it makes a profit, but that profit is not government's income. This is not the government's income. Government's income is out of that profit. Whatever dividend that PSU gives is now the income of the government. Okay? Is that clear? Owner gets dividend. Owner does not get profits. Never in any company. So my income as an owner, Kinsook, that each company decides on its own. There is no fixed percentage. Of course, it's not possible. Every company will decide its own percentage every year, right? In fact, a lot of times it may decide not to give any dividend. That depends on company to company and situation to situation. Okay. So another source of income could be from duty surcharges. So for example, I take a certain commission, fee, or cess on any transaction. Suppose the government sells certain assets like spectrum, and for the application of the tender, it charges a $1,000 fee. So that will be a fee income. It's generally a very nominal amount. Okay, so this is a very small source of income for the government. Very, very small source. That is why generally it is not mentioned even separately. Okay, the income is just clubbed into the income from operation of assets. Shashwat, profit. So any company, when it runs, okay, let me just show it to you on a new worksheet. Okay, I'll come back to this worksheet in a minute. Let me just show it to you on a new worksheet. So any company which runs, and this is not just the public sector units, this is any company which operates will always have incomes, just like we did for the government, and expenses. So income for any company will be its sales. Let's say the sales is 100 rupees, and there'll be some expenses here. And then once you deduct the expenses from sales, there will be a profit figure, right? So let's say the company is making 20 rupees of profit. Now this is the profit of the company. Okay, this is not the profit of the owners. Company and its owners are separate. Ashik, they are not taxes, but they are charges, or you can call them fee, or you can call them commission, which a government charges. It's like an agency fee, okay, which they can charge on transactions. okay? For example, you go to a post office, they'll charge you a nominal amount for a transaction. Now, the post office is a body of the government. Yeah, Shashwat, I'll come to that. So profit is 20 rupees. Out of this profit, the company may decide to retain some money for future business. It may also decide to give some money to its owners, which is called dividend. Okay. Avinash, in short, yes, there is a difference technically when we talk about accounting terminology, but in short for this session, yes. Okay. So guys, this is the dividend. So the owner gets this. So let's say the company decides, I'm going to pay just 5 rupees to the owners and I'm going to retain 15 and put it back into my buying my raw materials, buying my paying my labor, paying my electricity bills. So I'm going to retain these 15 rupees. So a company can do that. Right? A company can decide to retain certain money for its operations. Okay? So that part is the money it doesn't pay to the owners. If it pays money to the owners, it can do so in form of dividend. So if we are talking about a PSU here, so suppose this is a public sector company, the owner is the government, or a large part of the ownership is with the government. So this dividend will go to the government. Okay? So that is how government can earn from the operations of the company. Shubham, it is just in the shape of payment. So it can be in shape of check also, it can be in shape of account transfer also. It is never cash. It is in shape of account transfers or checks or demand drafts. Okay. So guys, this is the sources of income. Anything else over here in terms of income? Any other head of income that you can think of? FDI is not income, not at all. Customs have already included here in the indirect taxes. Loans, Arushi, is again not income. So even though you are partly correct, Arushi, but not completely. Lease of government land will be, okay, so sale, let me include lease over here. So whatever income I get from that is income, you are correct. But I will include that. It is similar to sale, so lease. Import charge is the same as customs duty, here already discussed. Anything else, guys? Customs, imports, anything else? Sale of stamps is the fee that we are talking about here. Arvind, what else? Exports is not income for the government, Samira. Export is always income for the exporter. It is an exporter sitting in Chandigarh or Ludhiana or Delhi or anywhere who is going to export, not the government. Shubham, technically, theoretically correct, but factually in India's case doesn't happen, no? When do we give a loan to any other country? We don't do that. We don't have the money. Yeah, so we don't really give loans. We take loans. Samira, so that will be income for the... So if a government PSU is exporting, it will show here. In the sales of the PSU, not the government. Understand? Do you get the point, Samira? This is a very clear understanding you must get. Sales is happening. It is export sales, but it is the PSU sales. And the PSU has this sale. It will translate into income here when it reaches the dividend point. This 100 is not going to be the government's income. The part of that which after profit is given to the government, that is the government's income. And now RBI bonds. No, not RBI bonds also. That is part of what earlier somebody had said, which is the loans. So we'll talk about that when we talk about loans. So nothing else, guys. There is nothing else. So whatever fee or commission that you get, Ashik is correct. So you get that over here. Commission, fees, absolutely. But like I said, this entire thing, duties, commission, fees, cess, is very negligible, 0.01%. Terminology, Abhishek, not really too much. See, education cess is what probably you've heard of, and surcharges are basically for social welfare schemes. Okay, so it's just a terminology difference. Otherwise, it is just an additional tax which you have to pay. Okay, so this is a tax which you might hear of in terms of service tax and even income tax. You'll hear there are cesses and surcharges charged, but this is just terminology. Generally, cess is used with education, surcharges are used with social schemes. Okay, chalo guys, so other than this, there is no other head of income on the right side. Yeah, Abhishek, absolutely. On this side, guys, what are the expenses of any government? Expenses. Arushi, just does what make a difference? Yeah. Oh, very good. Lots and lots of points. So I'll try and club these points into three heads. Okay. The first head, very big, is subsidies. The third head, again substantial, is interest. The second head is what we will call, for the purpose of our session, government spending, which includes salaries of government employees, it includes defense, it includes infrastructure spending, it includes social spending like education, school, hospitals, bridges, roads, right? So it includes all of these sets of spending. It includes, just a minute guys, just give me a minute. Yeah, so all of these heads of spending, so social spending, like for example education sector spending, medical sector, health sector, building roads, hospitals, ports, right? So all of this infrastructural development spending is all part of government spending. Okay, so I'm going to club that in all. There's a reason I'm clubbing it. I'll explain that little later. So this is the government spending. Anything else that you can think of except this, guys? Any other thing except these three? So there's subsidies, there is government spending on all these items, and then there is the interest on loans. Anything else? So we'll include that in social schemes. Yeah, so yeah, okay, so there is a relief. So various reserves are created. I'll call that reserves. So Pradhan Mantri, Prime Minister's Relief Fund, or any calamity relief fund. So reserves are created for various purposes. Also part of here. Kinsuk, loan given to farmers. Fine, that can be a specific scheme, right? So that will also be here. Bailing out Kingfisher, yeah, absolutely. That's also part of here. But for those things, reserves are created. Okay, so reserves are created for these kind of contingencies also. So we will talk about that here itself. Anything else? Right, so salaries of all government employees, including politicians. Absolutely. What else? Foreign aids, part of reserves. So reserves can be domestic and foreign, both. Yes. So if there's an Ebola crisis in Africa, the Indian government also commits certain funds, and the reserve, the payment is made from the reserves. That's also true. What else? Anything except then these three heads? So let me just quickly, Nepal, okay, fine. So that will be part of the reserves. Scientific development, R&D, yes, absolutely. Yeah. So contribution to other world bodies, absolutely. That's also correct. So essentially, guys, if you look at it, these are the three major heads. So all your points are correct, Sahil, Shubham. And I will include that within the social spending and the reserves. Okay. Now, if you look at these two sides, so there is the taxes, there is the income from assets, and then there is the duties. So like I said, this is negligible. We will not talk about this separately. However, generally in the case of India, you will find that the income side, the total of this side, is less than the total of this side. The expenses are more than the incomes. Therefore, in order to meet the expenses, the government of India has to borrow. Okay. So on this side, it's not an income, but in order to balance the two sides, there is a figure of borrowing. This is not an income, guys. This is just to balance the two sides. The government of India borrows in order to meet the shortfall from its income, in order to meet its expenses. Okay. Where does the government borrow from? The government borrows from three sources primarily. It borrows from international sources. So which includes World Bank, IMF, other countries. It can go to other bodies, other international bodies. The government can borrow from RBI. So as you guys were saying, the printing of currency. And it can also borrow from you and me. So which is borrowing from public in the shape of instruments like PPF, Provident Fund, Post Office Deposit Schemes, Kisan Vikas Patras. All of this, when you invest in a KVP or a PPF, you're actually lending to the government of India. Okay. So the government of India can borrow from the public. It can borrow from its banker, the RBI, and it can borrow from international bodies. Okay. So there are three sources of borrowing. So this is how the expenses and incomes look like for the government. Now let me explain the context to you. So the revenue budget, there's a term known as the revenue budget, guys. Now this revenue budget is the part of the budget which deals with revenue receipts and revenue nature expenditure. Okay. So revenue nature receipts are those receipts which come from any source other than sale of assets. Aditya, ask me this question in about 5 minutes. Yeah. Okay. So revenue receipts will be any receipts, any incomes of the government which come from sources other than sale of assets. In other words, this entire side, okay, this entire side, so which means, let me just change the color. Oh, this will be too bright. Okay. So this entire side, which means taxes, both income from operations and this, these are the revenue receipts. So any income other than income from sale of assets is a revenue receipt. On the other side, expenses of a revenue nature are any expenses other than those expenses to create assets. Okay, any expenses which are done to create assets. For example, expenses to create infrastructure are not revenue expenses. Subsidies are revenue expenses. Salaries are revenue expenses. Defense is revenue expense. Social sector spending is revenue expense. Interest on loans is a revenue expense. Okay, so the revenue budget again is revenues from tax and other resources except sale of assets and revenue nature expenditure, things like salaries, subsidies and the interest payments. Lease of assets generally is a long term, Karthik, and therefore it is capital nature. Anything which has a maturity of more than 1 year is a capital expenditure or a capital income. It will appear in the capital budget, not the revenue budget. Okay. This is the capital budget, guys. Capital budget is any expenses and incomes where, so from the incomes you sell assets, or the expenses will be where you create assets. Okay. So essentially the capital budget consists of infrastructure spending generally, this part. So expenses of a capital nature and incomes of a capital nature. Okay, so this is the capital budget. Is that clear, guys? revenue budget, capital budget. Chalo. Now the three kinds of deficits. So first you must understand the fiscal deficit. The fiscal deficit is very simple. It's a term which you would have heard very often. I'm sure you would have heard a lot of discussion around this term. The fiscal deficit for the year 2014-15. Sorry. So for the year 14-15, that is the current financial year, is 4.1% of GDP. Shubham, that is next year. 4.1 is the figure for this year. So fiscal deficit is the excess of all the expenses over all the incomes. Okay? So I'll explain this with the help of that chart again. So fiscal deficit, guys, will be when this exceeds this, and it does our expenses. So this is all the expenses, capital and revenue, exceed all the incomes. That is called a fiscal deficit. So all the incomes, I'm taking all, both revenue nature incomes and capital nature incomes, all the incomes and all the expenses. So this side exceeds this side. And this here, I have not taken borrowing. Like I said, borrowing is not an income. So we are not talking about borrowing here. Borrowing is to balance it out. When there is a fiscal deficit, we take a borrowing. Yes, Kinsuk, absolutely. Yes, we take loans and the fiscal deficit reduces. Absolutely, that's the whole idea. Rahil, no. Actually, the concept of a fiscal deficit in itself is not bad for any economy. Why just a developing economy? But the point is, the reason for the fiscal deficit. Now, when you look at the Indian economy, the reason is a problem. The reason is not developmental in nature. Okay? So, had the reason been that our fiscal deficit exists because we are going to spend a lot of money here, that's excellent. Love it. Because you are spending on building roads, 8-lane highways, ports, telecommunication equipment, technology, digitizing stuff. But that's great. But our fiscal deficit is existing largely because of this and because of this. And that's a problem. Okay? So that's the issue. It's not in concept, fiscal deficit is not bad for any country. Okay, why just India? Okay, let me just read out your questions. Okay, Kinsuk, yes, over a period of time, as you have seen in the case of the US and in the case of European countries, over a period of time, over a period of 10, 20 years from now, let's say after 20 years from now, the loans might become a headache for India as well. But along with that, you have to understand that spending is important. It is necessary to grow the economy. The government has to spend. If the government doesn't repair the roads, you will be the first person to say, "Yare, ye kya bakwas hai? India to country aisa hai." So the government has to repair those roads. They have to make bigger roads. As the traffic congestion increases, they have to build flyovers. They have to build underbridges. They have to build metro rails. They have to do those things, no? So Kinsuk, expenditure is necessary to develop. So that it will create a headache in future cannot be a reason to stop spending. However, the issue largely is with the other issue, the other heads, which is the subsidies and the interest. These are the major headaches for India, not the loans in itself. Okay. Yeah, so Avinash, fiscal deficit generally means that you have, see, essentially Avinash, look at it this way, yaar. आपको यहाँ पे अगर 100 रुपए खर्चने हैं, these are expenses which total 100 rupees, and these are things which total up 80 rupees. So that means there's a fiscal deficit of 20 rupees. You will take a loan to spend, no? आप ये 100 रुपए खर्चोगे कैसे? जब तक आपके पास 20 रुपए और loan नहीं आएगा. So essentially yes, you are taking a loan to bridge your fiscal deficit. Absolutely. Otherwise how will you make the spending, no? Ashish, That's a very weird question. Yeah, what is the government? It represents the national income and the national expenses, right? Are they making the roads for their own traveling? They are making the roads for the country. Yeah, so fiscal deficit for the country only. The government's income or the government's expenses means the country's income and expenses. No, get it? Kinsuk, in short, yes. I mean, I can't really go into the pigs and the European crisis. Even the American society is facing a similar situation. You might have heard a couple of years something called the fiscal cliff in the US. So it's a very similar situation there as well. But I will not go into those details. Otherwise, we will not even start the budget. Okay? So anyway, so fiscal deficit is the excess of all expenses, all of these guys. Again, it's the sum total of this entire side, everything put together, over all the incomes, except the borrowing, again and again. So the borrowing is not an income. Okay? So our expenditure is more than the entire set of incomes. So that's the fiscal deficit. Then you have the revenue deficit. Basically, the revenue deficit is the difference between revenue spending, which is greater, revenue expenses, and the revenue receipts, which are less. So revenue expenses and revenue receipts, I've already told you those ones. The difference between the two, when the spending is greater, is called a revenue deficit. Okay, then you would have heard of terms like planned expenditure and non-plan expenditure. Now plan expenditure is all those items of expenditure which are outlaid as per part of achieving the 5-year plans. I'm sure you know that up till a certain time, in fact till August last year, there was something called the Planning Commission in India, and that body made 5-year plans in India. And in order to achieve those objectives later on in the 5-year plans, every year certain money was spent to achieve part of those objectives, right? So that was the plan expenditure. That was money which was allocated to ministries, to state governments, to union territories, as a part of achieving the plan goals. Okay, so for example, you want to make a national highway from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. That is there in the 5-year plan. Now in order to achieve that, I have to give certain money every year to the Ministry of Roadways, right? So that's a plan expenditure. Siddharth, because that money then gets accounted, no? So when you're taking a receipt or when you're buying a product with a receipt, obviously the money has to go into the government because there is something called an audit. So when for example, you buy a TV from a retailer, from a shopkeeper. Now the shopkeeper sells you the TV, great. But if you take a receipt from him at the end of the year, when the auditor comes to check his accounts, Arvind, give me a minute. So when the auditor comes to check his book of account, he will see, okay, so you've sold a TV and on that you've charged a tax. Have you paid the tax to the government? So that ensures the payment of the tax to the government. Okay. Theek hai, so let me come to Arvind's doubt first. Arvind, this is getting very messy, but I'll try to do my best. यहाँ तो बहुत गन पड़ गया यार. दिस इज नॉट गोइंग टू. अच्छा चलो, लेट मी चेंज द कलर. लेट्स प्ले टिपी टिपी टैप. विच कलर यू वॉन्ट? ठीक है, तो चलो. ओके, सो अरविंद, यू वॉन्टेड द रेवेन्यू रिसीट्स एंड रेवेन्यू एक्सपेंसेस. सो द रेवेन्यू रिसीट्स, अगेन अरविंद, आर द वंस विच आई हैव ऑलरेडी मार्क्ड इन द डार्क ब्लू पेन. सो अगेन आई, सो दिस इज ऑल द टैक्सेस, the income from operating government owned companies and the incomes from duties, commissions, fees, etc. This is the revenue incomes. The revenue expenses are subsidies, expenses like salaries, defense, social sector spending and interest payments. All of these are the revenue incomes and revenue expenses. Okay, and Kinsuk, the revenue deficit is the difference of revenue receipts, which I've just told, minus the revenue incomes, expenses minus incomes. GST will ensure that you will take a bill, Varun. Who told you GST there'll be no bills? GST will actually ensure that the bills are there in the system itself. When you buy a product, you'll not have to take a manual bill. It will automatically build, because part of the GST proposal is that it will become a single point software. So in the sense, the product, you've seen those, you know, those big codes, those, so product has a certain code attached to it. So that code will not get detached. You'll not be able to take out the product from the shop unless you've paid the amount, and which will include the GST payment. Shubham, aa rahe hain dost. Not barcode, it is the product code. Not the barcode itself, it's the product code. So there'll be a code embedded inside the product. It'll be like an RFID. If you've seen RFIDs. So it's like an RFID. It's a code embedded inside the product, where the product, once it is sold and that code is scanned, automatically the tax will be captured by the system and relate to the central government server. So that is how it will work. Okay. So automatically there's no need for a separate bill. Everything will be captured by the software. ठीक है जी, चलिए. So the plan expenditure is all the expenses which are of the objective of achieving the plan goals. And non-plan expenditure is everything else. So it include expenditure like the interest payments. It includes subsidies. It includes salaries. It includes defense. It includes pensions. All of these expenses are non-plan expenditure. Okay. Central plan outlay is another name for the plan expenditure. Okay. So these are the budget terms which I think you should know. Other terms which for this, Abhishek, actually this term is no longer really relevant. Yeah. Actually, the non-plan expenditure is the biggest share of the revenue expense. But actually, abhi ye term itna relevant raha hi nahi, because planning commission ko khatam kar diya. Okay, so the planning commission is no longer there. It has been replaced by the Niti Aayog, which is not going to make 5-year plans. At least they have not said it so far. So essentially, the five-year plans nahi honge, to plan expenditure ki distinction khatam ho jayegi. Okay, so itna koi lamba choda difference nahi hai. Okay, so yes, Arvind, I can do that. If you want, but I can do that for 13-14, because 14-15 the final figures have not yet been announced. So I can give you the figures of all of these for 13-14. Okay, so it's going to be in rupees. Okay, so in rupees the idea is like this, and the figures are in rupee, lakh, crore, or which is also the same as trillion. Rupees trillion. Okay, rupees lakh crore, or you can read it as rupee trillion. So trillion is the same as a lakh crore. Okay, Arvind ji, percentage mein nahi hota kabhi bhi, it is always absolute. Percentage baad mein nikali jati hai, aapko main bhi samjhata hu. Okay, so subsidies for 13-14, now these figures that I'm sharing with you are for financial year 13-14, ended 31st March 14. Subsidies were approximately 2 lakh crores. Government spending on all of these heads, all of them put together, was close to 10 lakh crores, and our interest payout was 4 lakh crores. Tax income was 9 lakh crores, and income from assets, both heads put together, both of these put together, was close to 2 lakh crores. So this was the expenses and the incomes. Ab agar aap isko total karenge, aap dekhenge there is a fiscal deficit which has to be funded by the borrowing, and the borrowing for 2013-14 was 5 lakh crores. Similarly, at the same time, I'll also tell you the GDP for the year 13-14. The GDP for the year 13-14 was 1,15,000 crores. 1,15,000 crores. Okay? So now if you look at this, अब हम बात करते हैं जो हमने शुरुआत में बात की थी, 4.1%. What is that? Now see the correlation, guys. 4.1% is 5 lakh crores divided by 115. Now Arvind, do you get the percentage? Yeah, so approximately इतना आएगा. सो दीज आर अप्रॉक्सीमेट फिगर्स गाइज. इट विल नॉट बी 5.6. या वॉट आर यू डूइंग सिद्धार्थ? सो समथिंग लाइक दिस, कुछ ऐसा ही आएगा. इट विल बी क्लोज टू 5%, लिटिल लेस देन 5 एक्चुअली. हाँ, सो दिस इज हाउ यू अरविंद कम टू द परसेंटेजेस. करण जी, दैट इज डॉलर्स एंड दैट इज फॉर 13-14 विद द ओल्ड बेस ईयर कैलकुलेशन. या आदित्य, यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट. नॉट 2010, इट इज नाउ विद 11-12. 2012 योर नंबर इज रॉन्ग. द करेक्ट बेस ईयर नाउ इज 11-12. आई विल कम टू दैट किंसु 5 मिनट्स. तो करण जी, द जीडीपी 1.8 trillion dollars इज फॉर डॉलर्स, इज डॉलर्स एंड इट इज विद द ओल्ड बेस ईयर कैलकुलेशन 2004-05. करण, नाउ वी आर फॉलोइंग 2011-12 बेस ईयर. ओके, सो गाइज, व्हेन वी से 4.1% इज फिस्कल डेफिसिट, वी आर सेइंग दिस नंबर एज अ परसेंटेज ऑफ दिस नंबर. गेट इट? Shubham, we haven't even started talking about the budget, yeah? I'm just trying to explain the basics of the budget. How do we understand a budget document? Abhi toh is baar ke budget pe toh hum shuru bhi nahi hua, yaar. So, I think, just give me a few minutes, yeah. Guys, is this clear? Have we got to be on the same page? Do we understand how fiscal deficit is calculated? Chalo, great. Now, let me move on pretty quickly, guys. Okay. So GAR, everybody understands GAR? So tell me if anybody has a problem with any of these terms. Yeah, so GAR, GST, current account deficit, CAD is current account deficit. Then there's MAT, and then there's the four schemes. So Jan Dhan, Make in India, Swachh Bharat and Aadhaar. Which ones do you want me to explain, guys? Okay, so I'll explain GAR. Chalo, theek hai, so GAR. GAR and MAT. Okay, great. So I'm assuming everybody knows GST or is fairly familiar with GST. Current account deficit, is everybody understood? Current account deficit? Yeah, okay, great. So GAR basically is the general anti-avoidance rules, guys. Yeah. Actually, it's the other way around, Arvind. It's imports minus exports. Deficit always occurs when the imports are more and the exports are less. ठीक है, तो एनीवेज, GAR इज द जनरल एंटी अवॉइडेंस रूल. सो अ फ्यू इयर्स बैक, दिस इज व्हेन प्रणब मुखर्जी वाज अ फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर, दैट इज अबाउट 4-5 इयर्स बैक, ही केम आउट विद दिस प्रोविजन एंड ही सेड दैट एनी फॉरेन कंपनी हु वांट्स टू ऑपरेट इन इंडिया कैन डू सो, बट दे हैव टू पे टैक्स. बट अ लॉट ऑफ कंपनीज वर ऑपरेटिंग इन इंडिया and they were based in tax havens like Mauritius, places where taxation is either very low or taxation is not there. So they ended up avoiding paying tax. So Pranab Mukherjee came out with this GAR. So GAR says that unless the company is coming from a country which has a DTT with India, a double taxation treaty with India. So unless a company is coming from a DTT country, All other companies coming from all other countries have to pay GAR. So which means if India, let us say Mauritius and India don't have a DTT, and a company comes in to do business, it is operated from Mauritius, it has to pay tax under GAR. So unless there is a DTT agreement between India and some other country, एंड आप उस कंट्री से आ रहे हैं, यू विल हैव टू पे GAR. ओके, इंडिया हैज डीटीटी विद मेनी कंट्रीज वरुण, बट मॉरिशियस हैज नो टैक्सेशन एट ऑल. ओके, मॉरिशियस हैज, इट्स अ टैक्स हेवन. ओके, सो दैट इज व्हाई मॉरिशियस इज अ बिग बोन ऑफ कंटेंशन. इनफैक्ट मोस्ट ऑफ आर फॉरेन इन्वेस्टमेंट फ्लोज कम इन फ्रॉम मॉरिशियस रूट, मच मोर देन यूएस, यूरोप, दुबई, एनीवेयर. मोस्ट ऑफ आर फॉरेन फ्लोज कम इन फ्रॉम मॉरिशियस. It's very simple, Shubham. That country decides दैट मेरे कंट्री में जो जो कॉर्पोरेट्स रजिस्टर्ड हैं उनको मैं टैक्स नहीं लूंगा. फॉर एग्जाम्पल एवरी कंट्री डिसाइड इट्स ओन टैक्स रेट्स, राइट? सो मॉरिशियस सेज आई डोंट वांट टैक्स, कॉर्पोरेट टैक्स इज नॉट देयर और वेरी लो. सो इट्स अ कंपनीज, इट्स अ कंट्रीज टैक्स लॉ, नो? दे चार्ज टैक्सेज ऑन प्रोडक्ट्स, दे चार्ज टैक्सेज ऑन इंडिविजुअल इनकम्स, दे डोंट चार्ज कॉर्पोरेट टैक्स. किन्सो आप इंडिया की बात कर रहे हैं? What is DTA, Varun? Where is the context of this? I don't understand. What DTA are you talking about? Kinso, this year the budget, Jetli has announced that the corporate tax will be reduced to 25% over a period of 4 years. Currently it is 30% plus surcharge. Yeah, Varun, you're right. So double taxation treaty is also called double taxation avoidance. Yes, Abhishek. So what's the question? Yeah. What is your question, Abhishek? See, Abhishek, let's say a company X is registered in Mauritius and wo Mauritius mein registered hai, India mein apna products bech raha hai. Theek hai? Now, when it comes to the end of the year, he says, मेरे प्रोडक्ट्स का टैक्स मैं मॉरिशियस में दूंगा बिकॉज मेरे प्रोडक्ट्स की डेवलपमेंट मॉरिशियस में होती है, उसकी कॉस्टिंग मैं मॉरिशियस में करता हूं, इसलिए उसका जो रेवेन्यू है उस पर टैक्स भी मैं मॉरिशियस में ही दूंगा. अंडरस्टैंड? सो इंडियन टैक्स इज लॉस्ट, सो इंडियन गवर्नमेंट लूजेस दैट टैक्स रेवेन्यू. दैट इज द बिग प्रॉब्लम. Kinsuk, if the DTT exists, the tax will be as per that specific DTT. So every DTT will have a specific detail ke yaar tax kahan pe lagega aur kitna lagega aur will it be shared between India and China. So it will be as per that specific agreement between those two countries. Okay? But when the DTT is not there, Pranab Mukherjee said you have to pay tax under GAAR. So all the foreign investors suddenly said, "Arre, what is this nonsense? Then why will we come to India?" So then a lot of the foreign investors got spooked and GAAR was deferred. It was deferred by Pranab Mukherjee, then it was deferred by Chidambaram. Now it has been deferred for another 2 years by Jetli. Okay. Now coming to MAT. MAT is the minimum alternate tax. Okay. So if you look at the concept of MAT, it was introduced about 10 years back. Okay, about a decade back, and the whole idea behind MAT is that a lot of companies don't pay tax which is due. Okay, now let me explain how is that done. Because a lot of exemptions are available in income tax. Okay, under the income tax law, a lot of exemptions are available for both individuals and for corporates who have to pay corporate tax. तो वो exemptions की वजह से, suppose now a company is earning 100 rupees in sales, okay, the same examples we used earlier, and they earn a profit of let's say 20, okay. Now if the corporate tax rate is 30%, they should pay 6 rupees as tax, correct? But then the corporate avails of certain exemptions and it ends up paying just 1 rupee or a lot of times 0. It pays no tax also. So in these situations, again, the government ends up losing tax revenue. Okay. So at that time, the government decided about 10 years back, they decided that, okay, if you decide to avail the exemptions, that's fine. You can do that. The exemptions are there to be availed. But every company which is showing a book profit, this is called book profit. So if it is showing a book profit, it has to pay minimum 18.5% tax. It is called the MAT. कि अगर आपका exemptions लगाने के बाद आपका 6 रुपया tax बन रहा था, exemptions लगाने के बाद you ended up paying 0, but you still have to pay 18% of this figure. Okay? So this is the minimum tax which a company has to pay in any case, even if the exemptions allow you to take allow you to pay lesser tax, but you still have to pay 18%. Again, companies were not happy. Minimum alternate tax, Abhishek. It's called the minimum alternate tax. Companies were not happy with this as well. This has been a grouse for the last 10 odd years. But yeah, abhi bhi hai. It is still there. Okay. So this is the... Shashwat, will come to GST in some time. Yeah, we'll come to that. So yeah, you're right. It is going to be around 24. It is going to be between 22 to 25%. But it has not been finalized yet. Okay. I'll just come to that. Chaliye. Let's move on. There are three events which you need to know about which happened pre-budget. Before I come to the budget, three events have happened before the budget which are important. The first is the GDP has been revised. Like I was just telling you guys, the GDP base year, the base year which is taken for the calculation of GDP, earlier used to be 2004-05. It has now been moved to 2011-12. This is just a month old. In January, it was changed to 11-12. Okay. So therefore, the GDP, which was earlier showing a very low number, has suddenly shot up. So for 13-14, so the GDP for, let me just do these numbers here. So 13-14, I'll explain that, guys. I'll explain that. So for 13-14, the GDP earlier was about 4.5%. With the new calculation, it stands at close to 7%. For 14-15, which is the current year, the GDP forecasted was close to 5.5%, and now it is finally showing 7.4%. So 15-16, the forecast with the new base year is close to 8%. Okay? Yeah, we are talking about growth rates now. This is the GDP growth rates that we are talking about. Now, what is this base year and why has it changed? Base year is the year which is taken as a base from which inflation effect is calculated, guys. Okay. So there is something called the nominal GDP and something called the real GDP. Okay. Now, nominal GDP, which is the GDP which includes the effect of inflation, and these numbers that you keep on hearing, GDP growth rate, hum baat karte hain 5%, 6%, 8%, the numbers that you hear regularly, these are real GDP growth rates. Okay. Real GDP. This is not the nominal GDP. So every year, the Central Statistics Office comes out with its GDP calculation, and from time to time, every few years, they even change their base year calculation. So if the base year becomes more current, obviously the impact of inflation will be lower because past wala base year hai. So imagine this, guys. If I want to look at it, you know, suppose you look at it this way. So if I were to say 2004 versus 2015, the difference in prices of products, which is inflation, will this difference be higher, or will the difference be higher from 2011 till 2015? Will this difference be higher in prices, or will this difference be higher? Hai na? So when the difference is higher, which means the effect of inflation is higher here. So when I change the base year, that means the effect of inflation is less and real GDP is higher. Okay. So the real GDP goes up by changing the base year, making it more current. That is what has happened. Okay. So GDP of 13-14 has been revised. The TGP of 14-15 has also been revised. The GDP forecast for the next year has also come at 8%. Okay. Why to change base year? Because Aditya, if I keep on using the, you know, let's say if I use the inflation of 1947 and I show a very high inflation, 1947, 25 paise ka burger, aaj 150 rupay ka burger, how absurd will be my numbers, yeah? Hai na? So I have to keep on using a realistic base year in order to show a realistic GDP, hai na? Abhishek, nominal GDP is the GDP which includes the effect of inflation. Again, so simply I'll explain it here. So let's say a burger was 100 rupees last year. Okay. And I'm sure all of you know what is GDP, right? It is the sum total of all output produced. So which is goods and services produced in a country in a year. That is fine, GDP. So let us say in 1 year, one burger was produced. That burger sold for 100 rupees. So the GDP will be 100. Varun, wait. Let me answer one thing first and then I'll come to your question. Yeah, so one burger which cost 100 rupees was produced, got sold, and that means the GDP was 100. Next year, let us say now two burgers get sold and the burger price has also gone up to 110. So which means the GDP is now 220. But in this increase from 100 to 220, there is some effect of output increase and some effect of inflation increase. Correct? So we are just separating the two. Understood? Abhi ye clear hua ki nahi? Theek hai. Chalo, Varun, now coming to your question. Yes, it has, because essentially what they are saying is that this should have been done after a certain time, like a decade or so. So aapne 2007-8 mein change kiya tha. 2007-8, the base year was changed to 2004. And now immediately in the next 5-6 years, you have again changed the base year. So it's too soon. So while that may be true, maybe it's the government which has done this push in order to show a better picture of its performance. But the realistic answer remains that jo inflation hai wo aaj nahi to shayad 4 saal baad aap 2011 ka year lete tab bhi yahi number dikhata, right? So yeah, the government has done it now. It's little too soon, maybe a couple of years too soon, but kabhi na kabhi to this base year had to change. Okay, yeah, so that's right. So the number is showing that. Now that is the one change which has happened before the budget. The second is the Finance Commission report, where they recommended that states should get a higher share of the center's tax revenue. So in the center, the government of India gets tax revenue, as you just saw, and part of that is shared with the center, the states of the country. So it used to be 32%, and the 14th Finance Commission recommended that that share should go up to 42%. Okay, so this was the second major change. Shubham, I think so. I think that is the case, because they have to give a carrot to the states in order to get the GST proposal through. So I think you're right. It was a carrot for the states. And the third big event before the budget was the economic survey. This is a survey which is done and presented generally before, one day before the budget every year. Okay. And it is presented by the chief economic advisor. Okay. And this year the economic survey came out and showed a very nice picture that the Indian growth story is on track. We are likely to grow at around 8% in the next year. They talked about the jam trinity. They call it the jam trinity. So they said that you have the Jan Dhan, you have the Aadhaar, and the mobile. So mobile phones, handsets. So they said that, you know, in order to this problem, like I showed you, know, so I had showed you that there's a problem with our subsidies. I had told you that this is a big issue. Now, in order to plug this issue, in order to stop wastages here, leakages here, they came out and said you can use the jam trinity. So which basically means that, yeah. So which basically means that you have the Jan Dhan accounts, okay, Jan Dhan accounts. Now you have the Aadhaar numbers, which is the national identification number, and then you have mobile handsets with a large part of the population. 90% of the population has mobile phones. So they said we should transfer subsidies with the direct benefit transfer scheme, which is the Aadhaar national identification. They should be transferred into the Jan Dhan accounts. And those Jan Dhan accounts are accessible to the mobile handsets through mobile banking. So they said these three, right? So the Jan Dhan, they said the government wants to give a subsidy. It will transfer that subsidy based on the Aadhaar. That Aadhaar account is linked to the, that Aadhaar number is linked to the Jan Dhan account. And that Jan Dhan account is operated by the guy with his mobile phone. So they said these three things, Aadhaar, Jan Dhan, and mobile, रायल नो यार, जनधन इज नॉट विद द यूपीए. द यूपीए लॉन्च द आधार स्कीम एंड मोबाइल इज बेसिकली एन इकोनॉमिक कॉन्सेप्ट. सो मोबाइल फोन्स आर देयर इन द कंट्री एंड लॉट ऑफ पीपल हैव देम, 90% ऑफ देम. बट जनधन वॉज लॉन्च बाई द एनडीए, राइट? सी द प्रॉब्लम राहिल इज दैट यू नो एवरीबडी हु इज इन द ऑपोजिशन विल मेक अ फस. लुक एट वॉट इज हैपनिंग विद द लैंड ऑर्डिनेंस. या इफ यू लुक एट क्लोजली वॉट इज द लैंड ऑर्डिनेंस ऑल अबाउट, इट इज द सेम थिंग विच द बीजेपी वॉज प्रोटेस्टिंग अबाउट अर्लियर एंड नाउ वॉट यूपीए इज प्रोटेस्टिंग अबाउट, इट इज द सेम थिंग विच दे हैड रिकमेंडेड अर्लियर. सो ऐसा नहीं है कि ऑपोजिशन में आ जाएंगे तो यू नो यू स्टिक टू योर वर्ड. इंडियन पॉलिटिक्स इज लाइक दैट ओनली, दे क्विकली चेंज देयर फेस. तो पॉलिटिकली फर्स्ट तो होना ही है ऑपोजिशन से, जो मर्जी कर लो. या शुभम, यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट. बीजेपी अर्लियर हैड ऑब्जेक्शंस टू पार्ट ऑफ द बीजेपी रूल स्टेट्स, दैट इज हैड पार्ट ऑब्जेक्शंस टू द जीएसटी रोल आउट. ओके, इन सो दैट्स वेरी सिंपल यार. आई एम श्योर यू गो बैक एंड टॉक टू योर फोक्स एट होम. सब्सिडी इज ऑलरेडी बींग ट्रांसफर्ड थ्रू योर पेरेंट्स बैंक अकाउंट फॉर एलपीजी, राइट? सो इट इज गोइंग टू गेट ट्रांसफर्ड वेरी सून इन द नेक्स्ट फ्यू ईयर्स, मे बी इवन फॉर फूड ग्रेन्स, for fertilizers, for fuel, petrol, diesel. So whatever subsidies exist at that time, the subsidies will come directly to your bank accounts, your Aadhaar linked bank accounts. So that is the proposal under the Aadhaar scheme. Okay, so this is the third major announcement, okay, which was there in the economic survey. Now finally guys, coming to the major announcements in the budget. So the budget also talked about the jam. They said that the GST would get implemented from 1st April 2016. They hinted, gently hinted, that the states were on board. A very big positive of the budget was that it implemented the recommendation of the Finance Commission. So this one, where the Finance Commission said that 42% of tax revenue should go to the states, this was implemented in the budget. Okay. The budget, Jetley talked about selling some 6 PSUs and divesting the government stake in some other PSUs, but he didn't mention how much and which PSUs he's talking about. Another big announcement. So this is a very big announcement. This is a big announcement. This one is big. Another big announcement on this sheet is the one of the bankruptcy code, where Jetley said that they will create a new bankruptcy law. Okay. So for example, if you look at this, the case of Kingfisher Airlines, वो जितने लोगों ने लोन दिया है SBI एंड ऑल द अदर बैंक्स, दे आर स्टिल स्ट्रगलिंग आफ्टर अ कपल ऑफ इयर्स टू रिकवर द लोन्स आफ्टर सेलिंग ऑफ, दे स्टिल नॉट बीन एबल टू सेल ऑफ किंगफिशर्स एसेट्स. सो द इंडियन करंट लॉ, विच इज द BIFR, करंटली द इंडियन लॉ डीलिंग विद बैंक्रप्सी ऑफ कंपनीज इज द BIFR. इट इज अ टूथलेस लॉ, इट इज अ यूजलेस लॉ. कंपनीज कैन सिट प्रिटी, मालिया कैन सिट एंड वॉच इज IPL मैचेज एंड नोबडी कैन टच हिम. So the finance minister came out and said, we'll come out with a new bankruptcy code in which the lenders will get their funds back much more quickly, much more easily from bankrupt companies. Okay. Another big proposal was of the Mudra Bank. Essentially, this will be a refinance bank. Basically, you have microfinance institutions in the country. So you have MFIs who give loans to the rural unbanked sector. And these loans will be refinanced by the Mudra Bank. Okay, so this is the purpose with which Mudra Bank is being set up, and it will have a 20,000 crore corpus. Okay, so these are the five major announcements, and all of them are good announcements. Okay, Shubham, bankruptcy code basically means that if a company fails, if a company is not able to do well, it is not able to succeed, and it is in a state of failure, current law makes it very difficult for the lenders of that company to recover their loans. There's a very long drawn process. Okay, and so therefore lenders who have lent to Kingfisher Airlines even today, after 2 years after Kingfisher has failed, are still sitting with empty hands. Okay, so the new bankruptcy code promises to be on the lines of the American bankruptcy law. Okay, wherein it will become very quick. Within a couple of months, a company can be declared bankrupt and all its properties and its assets can be sold. The lenders get their money. Okay, so this is the concept of the bankruptcy code. Mudra Bank again is a refinance bank. It will be a refinance agency. So the MFIs, the microfinance institutions will give loan to, or they are already giving loans to the poor, the unbanked, the rural customers, and their loans will be refinanced by the Mudra Bank. That is the proposal here. Okay. Arvind, it's very simple. Yeah, see, so let's say MFI gives a loan of 100 rupees to the customer. Let us say a small entrepreneur, let's say a handicraft worker sitting in a village. Now, this risk is now with the MFI. He's lent 100 rupees, he's got a risk of 100 rupees on his head. So the Mudra Bank will buy this loan from him. So Mudra Bank will take certain commission. Let's say Mudra Bank says, okay, I'll give you 98 rupees or 97 rupees, Mr. MFI. You take your money today and get out. You're out of the transaction. So now this 100 rupees stands as a loan with Mudra Bank. And if there is a default, it is a risk of the Mudra Bank. So this is called refinancing. Maine unke loan ke upar aage loan de diya. Theek hai? So this is how it works. MFIs, microfinance institutions, Arvind. Microfinance institutions. Okay? Chaliye. Now, the biggest focus of the budget this year was on this, the infrastructure sector. So, the infrastructure sector has been part of many speeches of Narendra Modi, and in the budget also, the focus was coming out very clearly. Okay? Shashwat, understand, yeah? Okay, I'll just come to you. Let me just come to the previous slide. Dekhiye, MFI ne 100 rupees ka loan de diya, correct? When I say 100 rupees ka loan, it means this is what is outstanding on the books. This includes the interest component. So actually the loan is 90 rupees plus 10 rupees mujhe interest aayega. Hai na? Koi bhi loan dete hai, so there's an interest element, right? So I am supposed to get back 100 rupees from this guy, correct? Fine. So I've lent him 90, but I'm supposed to get back 100 rupees. Now when Mudra Bank buys this loan from me, he'll give me 97. So on 90, I'll earn 7. I will not earn 10, right? And now this guy on 97, he has spent 97. When he gets his money back, he'll get 100. So both will earn, but they'll earn partly. Isne 10 rupaya diya interest, out of which 7 went to him and 3 went to him. Understood? They'll know, there's no question of less money. That 100 includes the interest, no? Okay. So like I said, infrastructure is the biggest focus in the budget this year. They've set up a specific fund called the National Investment Infrastructure Fund for investment in 20,000 crore investment of the government will be there in the infrastructure sector. Kinsukh, the biggest one is Bandhan, yaar, which has been given a banking license last year. You can check out Bandhan. Okay. Infrastructure fund with a 20,000 crore government contribution has been set up. Similarly, they've said that we will do other ad hoc infrastructural development for 70,000 crores. They've said we will do rural infrastructure development of another 25,000 crores. And then they said people who will do PPPs with us, infrastructure PPPs, they can issue tax-free bonds to raise funds. Very big announcement. This one is very big. Okay. They also said, in fact, I think the biggest announcement, the biggest takeaway of the budget is this, the plug and play concept. Okay. Which basically means, if any of you are from business families, you can relate to this. Today, if I want to start a business, it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of effort to get the required licenses. So for example, I have to get a service tax number, I have to get a sales tax number, I have to get, let us say if I want to open a shop, I have to get a shop's registration license, I have to get a cooking gas, right? So lots and lots of different licenses required to start a business today. So what the finance minister has proposed this time is that he will have 5 ultra mega power projects, so UMPPs, which will be plug and play. So what he says is, Mr. Businessman, Mr. Ambani, Mr. Birla, Mr. Tata, XYZ, you can apply for a power plant. Tender bharo, bid an amount. If you get a winning bid, if you are allotted a power project, okay, the government will, before giving you the power project approval, or along with giving you the project approval, it will give you all the required clearances. Aapko government land degi, aapko government environmental clearance karke degi. So they said that you operate the power project, you bid for it, you fill the tender, you win it, you win the bid, we'll give you all the clearances required in your hand. Imagine the implication of this. Again, I'm doubtful in India's bureaucracy and political setup if this is possible and if this can be implemented in reality. But agar ye ho jaye, it is a big game changer. Okay, imagine doing this. For a businessman, the biggest thing in India today is running from department to department. Yeah, so running from one department to the next, abhi ek ho gaya to agla ho gaya to teesra. Businessman keeps on doing that all his life. So if they are able to do this, if they are able to say, "Acha, aapko power project mil gaya hai, aapki winning bid hai, you will get the power project on so and so date. Along with that, we'll give you all your land clearances, we'll give you your environmental clearances, we'll give you all the licenses, you'll get your project ready to start." So if they can do it, it's an amazing announcement. I feel this is the biggest announcement of the budget this year. Okay, I remain skeptical on the ease of doing this, how easily the government will be able to do this, but if they can, it is very, very significant. Okay, so that is, I think, a very big one. And then, of course, they have announced that the ports, the sea ports, will be corporatized, which means that the structure of running the ports will have a corporate structure. There will be a board of trustees, and they will be running the ports in a corporatized manner. So that was the other announcement. So all of this is the big infrastructure push, infrastructure development push. Okay. Few other announcements which are not so big but still are significant. Narega, they said, will continue. In fact, they allotted funds for this. Another 40,000 crores, 35 plus 5,000 crore rupees has been allocated to Narega. They've announced a debt management cell, and this, they've also said that, you know, a forwards market commission and the SEBI will be merged. They've abolished the distinction between FDI and FII, so it will be single foreign inflows now. It will not be FDI, FII. And another very big one, I feel, is the monetization of gold. They've taken certain steps to monetize the gold in India. So they say that India has, I mean, I'm sure you've seen it with your mom and your girlfriends, a lot of gold is there. They say 20,000 tons. Okay. And they say that this should be monetized. Okay. Ravi, I'll come to that. I'll come back to that. And for that, they've said that, you know, we'll try and give people incentives to keep the gold in bonds, in the shape of gold, instead of physical gold, keep your gold in the shape of gold bonds on which you'll earn interest. Jewelers can get loans on the metal accounts they hold with the government of India. So basically, they've tried to monetize the gold which is sitting idle in people's homes. Okay. Chalo, so FDI, FII, yes, there's a difference, Ravi, but what essentially that they're trying to do is FDI, FII difference will remain in terms of operations, but in terms of law, right? So if you say, today the law says that if I want to invest, for example, in a bank, let's say I'm a foreigner, I want to invest in a bank, the law says I can invest 49% in FDI and I can invest another 26% in FII in a bank. But if I want to invest the whole thing as FII, I can't do that. The whole thing adds up to, let us say, 75% or 70. Let's say this is 25, so 74%. I can't invest the whole thing in FDI. I can't invest the whole thing in FII. So they've made this flexible, that if a foreigner wants to invest either in FDI or in FII, the single limit remains 74%. Okay, so that's the impact. So the foreign investors will get more flexibility. Yes, it will be additive. It will always be a total investment in a particular sector or company. Okay. They've announced the setting up of a few more AIIMS, IITs and IIMs, but nothing major. In fact, education and health sector was largely ignored this time. There was no new big announcement. No, Shubham, so this numbers that I just gave you, 49, 74, these are just example for the purpose of the example. These are not realistic. For every industry, every company, you have to check out the foreign investment law. Okay. So, ऐसा नहीं है कि 49 खत्म हो जाएगा. हो सकता है किसी में foreign investment totally 49 हो यार. किसी में हो सकता है total foreign investment 26 allowed हो. Right? So, I'm not giving you a number which is applicable to all companies, all industries. This is just an example. Samira, gold bonds are basically debt instruments or will be debt instruments. Just like a government bond, government of India bond. So, it will be a piece of paper. Let's say it value is 100 rupees. And you can buy this bond. It will signify gold, investment in gold. Okay. And you will earn interest on this. Right. So that is how the gold bond will work. Arvind, the purpose of abandoning the difference between FDI and FII is to give foreign investors more flexibility. Kinsuk, yes, government takes loans from people also in the shape of bonds. Like as earlier mentioned, you have PPF, post office saving. So, they will also have bonds, right? Yes, Ravi, gold value fluctuates. So, what is going to happen actually, the key attraction of this instrument will be that at the end of a year, let's say the interest rate is 3%. So, at the end of the year, you will get, let's say this was from one year period, okay? So, at the end of the year, you will get 100 rupees plus 3 rupees plus whatever appreciation has happened in the value of gold. You will get that also. Right, so that's the attraction in this gold bond. You'll get both. Depreciation, no. The face value minimum is there. So 100 to milega, 100 plus 3 to milega. But any appreciation you'll get. Yeah, cool. So depreciation, you won't get the brunt of that. Okay, so corporate tax, they are saying that we will reduce it over a period of 4 years. There is no clarity on how and when, but they are saying that we will reduce it over a period of 4 years to 25%. But along with that, the exemptions that we mentioned earlier, when we were talking about MAT, this is the income tax paid by companies. Yeah, you will get only money, Samira. The whole point is to reduce physical gold. Okay, so corporate tax is the income tax paid by companies. Okay. So this is going to be reduced, but those exemptions will go. With my exemptions, when we talked about MAT earlier, we said exemptions enjoy karte hain corporates, those will go. Yeah. And then they announced certain things for black money. They said, you know, the penalty on black money holding, if there's discovered that you're having black money, it will be 300%. And there's a jail term of up to 10 years. So pretty strict. They said we will give incentives for debit card and credit card transactions, and all individuals have to quote PAN number for any transaction above 1 lakh rupees. So certain steps to curb black money. Arvind, I'll come back to this. Let me just cover the major announcements first. Some others, they said that they will abolish the wealth tax. And from 1st April 2015, and instead there'll be a 2% surcharge on the super rich, right? So that was introduced. Couple of small, not so meaningful exemptions for the wealth tax is the tax which is levied on the wealth or assets of the rich people. Okay. So couple of announcements, not so substantial, small announcements for the common man, which is the income. Benefits, so taxation benefits to the common man. So medical deductions have increased by 10,000 rupees. Additional deduction has been given under the national pension scheme, and travel allowance has been raised to 2% additional surcharge. Ravi, yeah, correct. What is already 10%? Yeah. So which means if a super rich guy, which means super rich means 1 crore income, more than that. So if he's paying 30% tax right now, he will pay 30% plus 2% surcharge. ठीक है, 30% plus existing surcharges plus 2%. Yeah. Swachh Bharat, donations to Swachh Bharat are 100% tax exempt, right? So that is also announcement. These are not anything major. One big hit is going to be that your entertainment, restaurants, food products, anything with a service element, the service tax has gone to 14%. It was earlier 12.36. It is now 14%. That has gone up. Defense allocation has increased. There's a micro irrigation program which has been announced for the purpose of agriculture, right? Atal Pension Yojana, six crore toilets under Swachh Bharat, and then there's visa on arrival for citizens from 150 countries. These are the major announcements of the budget this year. Okay, but I think in terms of analysis, the most important ones, okay, are on the slides before this. So which is one, black money is one very big announcement. If it can be implemented, it's a very big one, right? So this is one very big announcement. The second very big announcement, like I said, is the monetization of gold. And the third biggest announcement here is the specific focus, clear focus on infrastructure. This is the best part of the budget this year, guys. Infrastructure has been really well thought out. Okay, I'll come to Atal Pension Yojana now. Okay, Atal Pension Yojana basically is a pension fund, Shubham. Basically, it's a pension fund where you can start contributing towards your own pension. Okay, and for the first year, the government will contribute 50%. So let's say you contribute 1,000 a month towards your pension fund. The government will match your contribution and they'll also contribute 1,000 a month for the first year, right? That is the Atal Pension Yojana. That is the announcement. So guys, these are the major announcements for budget 2015. If you want to ask me major takeaways, like I said, the biggest takeaway is the development, the thrust on infrastructural development. I think if it is done, if it is implemented properly, it's a huge game changer. However, there are a few misses. For example, agriculture, except for this micro irrigation, there is not too much in terms of agricultural focus. That is one definite miss in this budget. The second miss in this budget is with regard to the minimum alternate tax. Corporates are not happy with that. The minimum alternate tax should have had some reworking, right? Let me just share that with you. And the biggest, see Shubham, it's like this, yeah. You can avail 1.5 lakhs under 80C, right? 80C allows you 1.5 lakhs. Similarly, you had an existing exemption limit under 80D, 80CCC. Okay, 80E, 80F, etc. The other sections, if you look at all the exemptions of all those sections put together, that sum total which any individual, if they are able to take all the exemptions, that is 4.44 lakhs. But realistic nahi hai, you are right, because nobody can avail every exemption. And aisa to koi bhi nahi hoga jiska housing loan bhi hoga, education loan bhi hoga, salary mein se bhi 80C pura contribute karega, medical bhi pura hoga, sab kuch nahi hoga kisi ka bhi. Okay, so it's a theoretical number. Small enterprises, absolutely. Like I said, Arvind, when I was talking to you there on that slide, I was talking about the rural entrepreneurs. Essentially, this is essentially for those people who have had lack of professional banking facilities. Rural entrepreneurs, small scale entrepreneurs living in unbanked areas. So for them, Mudra Bank will be a help. Okay, education loan is already exempted, Shubham. There's a limit for that. Okay, exempted in the sense you get a deduction for that. Kinsook, FDI is when a foreign investor invests in business in India. They invest in setting up a business. okay? And for an institutional investor, FII is when the foreign investor invests in the Indian financial markets. They buy shares or bonds in the Indian markets, okay? NPS, Abhijit, is the National Pension Scheme. It's a separate section. Okay, let me just show it to you. Yeah, so it's a separate section under which additional 50,000, if you invest in the National Pension Scheme, you'll get a deduction from your taxable income. Basically, you'll save tax on this 50,000 rupees also. Okay. शाश्वत समथिंग हैज टू इंक्रीज या अगर आपको कहीं वो एग्जेम्पशन दे रहा है यहाँ पे एग्जेम्पशन दे रहा है यहाँ पे उसने आपकी लिमिट बढ़ा दी यहाँ पे आपको टैक्स फ्री दे दिया ठीक है ट्रैवल अलाउंस बढ़ा दिया तो कहीं से तो वो आपसे कमाएगा भी ना ही हैज टू अर्न टैक्स रेवेन्यू फ्रॉम समवेयर ही इज रिड्यूस्ड सम पार्ट ऑफ द डायरेक्ट टैक्सेस एंड इज रेज्ड वन इनडायरेक्ट टैक्स इट्स एज सिंपल एज दैट ओके Excise duty on some item is increased, Samira, but at the same time, some items, excise and customs has been cut. Okay, so different items it has been increased and decreased. You can check out the whole list online. National Pension Scheme, Shubham. Yes, Abhijit, this is separate over and above 1.5 of ATC. Kinsuk, essentially it will mean ownership in both cases. Yeah. In FDI, you invest and set up your business in India and therefore you own it. In FII, you invest in the share market and you buy shares of the company. So you will get ownership from that route also. So essentially both result in investment resulting in ownership. Ownership dono mein milta hai. Sirf aapka route different hai. Only the route is different. Rasta farag hai. Ownership to dono mein milta hai na. ठीक है या सो दैट इज आई थिंक फॉर टुडेज सेशन गाइस आई थिंक आई कवर्ड अ फेयर पार्ट ऑफ द बजट एंड इन केस यू हैव एनी डाउट्स यू कैन ऑलवेज कम बैक इन द नेक्स्ट सेशन राइट सो थैंक यू गाइस वी विल क्लोज द सेशन हियर टुडे